We've been a transition town now for, I think it must be, you keep losing track on it, but I think it's 11 years now, I think. And it all started when a group of people, particularly led by Rob Hopkins, but there were a couple of others, who decided that rather than just talk about things or get angry or feel desperate about the news, and at the time we were all really worried about peak oil alongside climate change, and instead of just complaining and feeling helpless, shouting at the government, whatever, why don't we do something? So way back when, Rob called everybody together, anybody who wanted to come in the town. It's since become known as the Great Unleashing, I think it's called now, or the launch of TTT. And he merely asked the town, okay, we're in the face of climate change, in the face of feeling hopeless, and the fact that oil prices may get so huge that nobody could afford anything, and fossil fuels are dying out and so on, in the face of all this despair, what can we do? What can we actively do? How can we each use our own skills to come up with something as a response? And out of that very first meeting, several ideas emerged. A whole range of different interests emerged. Well, people said, well, I'd be really interested in looking at energy and how we use energy in our community. Other people said, let's look at education. Let's look at the education system. Let's look at how we run our businesses. Let's just look at a whole range of different ideas. So starting from that very humble beginning, just asking the question, what can we do as a town? I think there were probably about 10 groups that emerged. One of them, I think, has now become TRESOC. It was the energy group. I think we've already spoken to Ian about that. So that was how TTT grew. Initially, just a whole load of people who were really enthusiastic. It was interesting, actually, because the Civic Hall, which is where we held the meeting, a big hall at the top of town, was absolutely full. So that suggested that there was an interest. And I think once you can gather people around an interest, a passion, you can capture people's imaginations and say, actually, you can do something. You don't have to just get angry. I think once people realised that, they felt, okay, this is good. We can use our particular interests and sets of skills and experiences to actually do something. And that's the birth of Transition Town. Now, since then, what's happened is over time, those groups have matured. Some have disappeared, some have grown stronger. But the most important thing, the most important message, I think, to people who don't know anything about transition towns is that if you can allow people to use their particular gifts, their skills, and everybody's got some interests and skills, if you can allow them to use those skills, if you can enable that to happen, and unite everybody around a single cause, in our case, way back when, it was climate change and peak oil. If you can get people together around that cause, then things can happen. And then this sense of, actually, anything is possible, because people have been given energy, they've been given a focus, they've been given an opportunity, and eventually we needed to shape that organisation a bit. We needed to communicate with the various groups, because if you've got 10 groups, everybody going off and doing their own thing, every now and then you needed to come together and you needed to talk with each other and just share the joy of what everybody was doing, but always coming back to that single focus, which is how can we collectively work towards climate change, or help to make the transition from now to a time when things would be very, very different. And actually, over the 10 years, we've just seen how different they can be. But the fact that we're still very alive and that our organisation has become stronger, become more mature, we've evolved, if you like, into different phases of our work. So in those early years, it was mainly environmentalists that came together that really decided to do things. So it was, maybe it was what we call in English preaching to the converted. People already wanted to do something. They wanted to do something, and this gave them a chance to do something.
Really?
So that was our first few years of just giving energy to those people and giving some cohesion to those groups. And then I guess our next phase was developing our organisation to make it easier for people, and that meant a structure. We had to find some money. At first it was just about volunteers and using our voluntary energy, but then they quickly grow into projects, and project needs support in some way, financial support or administrative support. So we had to raise money. Once you start raising money and you have maybe lots of people all involved, then you need some kind of organisation. So at first we had an administrator. We did manage to get money for an administrator. That was right towards the end of our first phase. And in our second phase, as we grew, we really needed to coordinate the organisation effectively. So we did manage, again, we were lucky. We managed to get funding, and we appointed a manager, or TTT, and she was with us for five years, I think, whatever. You lose track of time when you're involved in it. That was during that second phase, we started to make partnerships and reach out more. We were very aware of the fact that if you come to a small town, small community, and you create a movement, it's like transition, you start getting attention, and then people in the town start saying, "Hey, what are you doing? You know, are you taking over our town? What's going on here?" You know. So we were aware of that and felt that that was counterproductive. So we started to reach out and talk much more with people, engage with a whole range of other groups in the community. And now in our third phase, we're reaching out even further. We've got even more focused in our aspirations, but we also recognise that life has changed. So peak oil might not be the best thing to keep talking about now, but still the same challenges around fossil fuels and climate change and environmental concerns, but also there are also economic concerns. And you'll hear, I think a bit later, you'll hear about the Reconomy project here. And you'll hear, I'm sure, how that has reached out into a whole range of quite interesting areas nationally. And so on. And you know, one of the other big projects that we have at the moment is the Caring Town project, and that's really a recognition that one of the planks of TTT has always been about building a community that is resilient. It can cope with climate change, it can cope with economic shocks and so on, but you cannot be a resilient community if you don't care about the most vulnerable in the community. So the Caring Town project has been, it's been a way of recognising that we needed to work very broadly across both statutory and voluntary sectors on health and wellbeing across the community. I think that's a very interesting model for other communities across the country, but also across the world, because it's again using those basic principles of transition to say, don't just shout and scream. Do that by all means, but actually, and that's good for you as an individual. If you want to campaign politically or whatever, that's really important. But actually, doing something on the ground is also important, and it's actually about saying, what can we as a community do for ourselves? How can we help and support the most vulnerable? And the Caring Town project is—that's the one I'm most involved in—and you know, that has really brought together a network of 60, 70 organisations across the community who didn't know each other before. So much of this is about communication, actually, and how you communicate with each other, and creating the space to communicate with each other and so on, and that's what we've done. So we've developed a network which is now actually doing practical things in the community as well, not just talking, but actually doing stuff. We have food in the community. We have the Grown in Totnes project. We have there's transition homes. Some of these are tangential to TTT, but grew out of the work that we've been doing. So we have the transition homes project. Have you been told about that yet? Yeah. So you've got transition. You've got the energy projects like Tresok, food projects, wellbeing projects, economic projects, inner transition, which is really strong, and that's about. Yeah, that's what you were talking about earlier. They changed their name many times, but that's been a thread that's run through that sort of spiritual element of TTT. Caring Town. yeah, I'm trying to think. Incredible Edibles. I'm a trustee. In terms of the organisation, we've now got, if anyone's interested in were you interested in the organisational structure?
Yeah, to know how you manage to organise
how we
yourselves.
Work. Yeah, well, we've got we have what we call a core group, which is where all of the theme groups, everybody who's involved on the film festival, I forgot that too. See, this is trouble. You ask for a list. I haven't got the list in my head. But that's the same principle I was mentioning way back when, grew out of our initial projects, really. Once you've got a big load of people all working away, you need to come back. One person from each of the theme groups come together for core group once a month. So they meet once a month. And the purpose of that meeting is for communication and to talk about the direction of the organisation and so on, so that there is real coherence across the organisations. And then we are a registered charity, because that enables us obviously to get grants to run our projects. And the trustees look after the financial side of it, make sure that everything is above board and is legal. So we look after the legalities, and we also keep an overview over everything that's going on in TTT. So we make a point of, I'll just give you a for example of one of the things that all of us have to watch for. It's very easy for an organisation like this to become very political if you're not careful. And if you become political, you exclude people who don't have those political beliefs. So we've been really careful to always make sure that we're not seen as allied to any one political party. And that means that you have to be really careful who you invite to where, you know, to how the publicity is managed and so on. So that's partly the role of the core group, but it's specifically the role of the trustees as well to make sure that those things sort of stay, that the culture stays right. I think one of the other reasons that TTT has been so successful is because we have cared about those details. You can't write us off as saying, oh, that's an environmental party, or that's this or that's the other, that's important. And the other reason that I think we've been so successful is that we've constantly looked at what we've been doing and evaluated and said, okay, where are we going with this organisation? Have we got the culture right? Have we got the direction right? Has the context changed at all? Do we need to take that into account? What's being said about us out there? So we've been aware of all of that, because if you're going to bring change, if you're going to really make a transition, you really need to be aware of what you're transitioning to and from, and the bit in between, you know, the present. You have to know the present as well. So I think any organisation, I think that's why TTT has been so successful as a movement. You know, it doesn't claim to be anything grand. It's just quiet, you know, just quietly getting on, and not always, as I was saying earlier, not always holding this flag up saying, aren't we wonderful, this is what TTT is doing. Sometimes putting that down, but it's TTT people that are involved, you know, connected. So if we can't ever declare ourselves as Totnes independent of everywhere in the world, if we can't be a little bubble, then our transition probably could never be complete. As to where we are, here, we have a long way to go. We're kind of just, it feels like we're just a small step, and you know, we've made some strides perhaps, but in the grand scheme of things it's probably only a small step. But we are trying, and I guess I suppose if we were to say, let's count this as a bit of a success, we're talking to you now today and sharing, and from that point of view, that's good. You know, we're further ahead than we were 10 years ago, a lot further ahead, and we are communicating with more people here in the town as well. So I think that's been useful. That's a long step, but and we're hopeful. So I guess if we can take that positivity, then I suppose we're, you know, it's hard to say where we are really. It's virtually impossible because the measure is changing all the time. You know, you plan for world, you think you're going one direction as a world, and then there's a change of president in the United States and you feel, oh my God, we're maybe not going there quite as quickly as we thought. So, you know, but I think the reason I've stayed with Transition Town for so long, you know, is because it actually feels like there's a hope here, there's a positivity, there's an energy, and you come out of meetings feeling energized, and that has to be good on a personal level and and in the town, because each of us lives in this town. So if there's that kind of positive energy, then you feel, okay, well, that's good. We can use that. There's something to use and build on, and you can net people in. You know, you can feel, come in, let's embrace you, you know, metaphorically. And I think that's, I don't know if that answers your question very well, but it's about the...
Really?
That's amazing. And I think we all feel gladdened by that, because, you know, it's all about sharing. We are lucky that we've got Rob Hopkins here, and that Rob is a great communicator. You need good communicators as part of of any organization. You need great communicators who are humble, and you know, I think that's another reason that probably it's been quite a successful organization. There's no room for egos. You know, there's room for people and individuals, but not for egos. It's a style of leadership that you need, that is a humble leadership, and it's actually just a it's almost like people just need convening, and it's just the role that person plays. You know, they need being brought together, and that person plays a part, but everybody else plays a part too. So I think that's a great feeling that it's grown. It's a fantastic feeling that it's grown, and you know, I hope it continues to do so. And the other amazing thing about it is that each transition initiative is different, and everyone finds their own way, because it depends on what skills you've got in any one group as to where it goes. So I think it's just exciting, really, and it's something to celebrate, really something to celebrate, yeah. So yeah, it feels good. Easily, I think, actually.
My questions will not be hearing. So if in your answer, can you...
Talk to you.
Talk what I'm asking. I mean, at the school or with the young people, we are trying to... You understand what I mean?
Oh, okay.
My question...
Oh, well, I don't work in schools anymore, but I think with the young people, what... Let me start again. It doesn't take long when you talk to young people to find a real passion in there. They're passionate about so much. They're passionate about climate change. They're angry about climate change. And I think channeling that was what we did in our town here. We channeled that energy and that passion into something positive. And I think it's actually just about saying to people, okay, be angry, but don't hold that anger and do nothing with it. Do something positive within your community. Every single little step makes a difference. And actually, that is the lesson from this town. You know, what started here 11, 12 years ago is now worldwide. And it wasn't anything grand. It was just a few people doing a bit of gardening, doing a bit of thinking about how they could save energy costs, doing a little bit of thinking about how they could change their little bit of their little town. It's all we are, just a small town. And I think, you know, for young people to take on that challenge, it's easy for them. They have energy, they have passion, they have belief in the world. And it's up to any adult, any parent, to help them to find ways of channeling that positively and not wasting so much energy on anger, which is what you see everywhere in the world at the moment. It feels, in this country, it feels angry at the moment, so often. But actually, there's no point. There's no point. They have all their lives in front of them. And my generation, we thought we were going to change the world, and we didn't. But a lot of us have carried on trying, and we've made a difference at some point in our lives. We're making a difference somewhere, and I think everybody can. So that's what I would say to young people. Use your energy, use your passion, we need you. I think there are lots of initiatives going on in schools. Again, they might not call them transition, but there are plenty of projects going on, really positive projects that are going on in our town and elsewhere in the world. The challenge is always to join those up and make them part of something bigger, but that's for educators to challenge themselves to do, I guess. But meantime, I think that's what each and every school should be doing, finding its own way. I mean, just in this country, we've just finally woken up a whole load of young minds on the impact of plastic on wildlife. And all over the country, you'll see young children taking masses of initiatives and getting very, very active about it. And I think it's just about recognising that. And we do here as much as we can. But it's always challenging institutions, of course. Well, we can't solve all the problems of the world. I know, and where we started with this conversation was saying that people were angry and they felt helpless and hopeless, and there was nowhere they could go with their anger. And what we decided to do was to try and model a change here in this community. And we have expanded that by sharing that conversation across the world and doing what we can. And it's very easy. Just the list of things that you just gave me there were you know, they instantly load on your shoulders this huge responsibility to change the world. And actually, I might want to do that with my politician's hat on, if I want to put one on. I might want to do that. I think we have to fight the politics. I think we have to be in there. But I do think that we have to separate out what you can do and what you can meaningfully do with your own community, because while we are really worried about all those things, there are people going to food banks in this town, and there are people who can't find work, they can't find homes, and so on. So I think it's really important that you don't forget what's going on in the world, but you do continue to work really hard on the ground to do what you can do and share it. And I think it is about communicating what you do as much as just doing it. I think you do have to share your modelling. You know, we are creating a model in this community of how people can resist some of the stuff that's going on out there. And that includes looking at economic change, which you'll hear a bit more about later. And we're doing our little bit on the ground in terms of economic change here in many different ways. The most obvious example is the work that Holly's trying to do in the Grown in Totnes work. And, you know, that so we're trying to build resilience in our own community. And you could build on that to become a national food strategy. But if you don't grow those ideas somewhere, then you can't feed those into the national debate. So it is quite, you know, it's a challenge, but it's not one that should depress you so much that you don't try and do it. We have got the Beyond Borders group here that are connected with us. You know, we're not a finite group of people. We're not the only ones doing things. I think part of what we are doing is sharing in the development of a culture which is compassionate and supportive here. I think it's all part of it. I think everybody plays their part in that. You don't tolerate the injustices that are being heaped on people, but neither do you claim that you can change the world, you know, and all on your own. You have to do it with people. So I think it is about creating the climate within the community. So many people say to us, oh, you're really lucky in Totnes, you've got all these active groups. But we are lucky, but we have made our luck, and we're continuing to make our luck with that. You know, I think the more we engage a whole range of people, it is about developing that compassionate town. So, you know, a sense of being compassionate, really, in everything, in nature and people, and the injustices of the economies and so on. You know, when I was a head teacher in an institution, in a school, you know, everything was so pressurized, you know, the meetings were pressurized, you had this, you know, it was all so bureaucratic and so on. And I used to try my best to make the meetings human. But if I went back now, I would do them differently. I would be more human. I would allow more time for human, for the human bit. And at every meeting we try, first of all, we use open space project. You know, the open space process. It's it's a process. It's a training. It's quite familiar for trainers. And if we have a public meeting, we would make sure that it's run in such a way that everybody gets a chance to speak, however, you know, or to participate in some way. So meetings are participative, however large they are, they will be participative in some way. Not you stand at the front and you talk. In our smaller meetings, we will always give time for a check-in, as we call it. So there'll be time built in so that everybody can just say how they're feeling. It doesn't take long, 1 minute, just to say, you know, it's been good, or I'm feeling good today, or whatever. And that immediately gives people a sense of belonging to the meeting. Everything is properly timed. The agenda is agreed at the beginning of the meeting, and then you time the agenda, you agree that timing, and you never go over. So you run your meetings very efficiently, and it's run... they are, in the main, you'll always work towards consensus. So those are kind of important bits, and that applies to how do you engage people? How do you get people to come to meetings? Well, they'll come if they think there's something important. So if there's a proper purpose to the meeting, and it's properly run, and it's efficiently run, and it's well led, with clear rules of engagement, then people come. You know, I must admit, I asked myself, why did they all come to that meeting, Caring Town? Why do they keep coming? Why do you get the chief executive of Southam's District Council, which is one of our local governments, why does he turn up to a meeting run by us? Why do they do that? And you think, well, it must be something to do with the culture of the meetings, or the purpose, or choosing the right moment. Being opportunistic is really important. When we set up Caring Town, we knew the idea of bringing 40 or 50 organisations in the town who were all working on health and wellbeing together. We knew that was a good idea, but we didn't think they'd come if we just said, well, come to a meeting. What we did was we did use the fact that there were severe cuts to budgets being made. So we invited people to come and have a conversation about that. And then we set the tone that actually we're all caring in this community, because all of the work you do is amazing. How can we make it even more caring, despite the fact that by working together, could we do something differently? And that's why people come, because they need to talk about it, because it's something important. That sounds a bit tame, but it's actually quite an important part of the process to get that question right. Get the right question at the beginning, and then you get lots of interesting answers. Get the wrong question, people close up. It's become so much more involved. One of our really brilliant projects that we did a few years ago, that was a major catalyst for change, actually, I forgot to mention this one, was a project called Transition Streets. And we got £625,000 grant from the government to do this. And we saw the opportunity, because they were putting out opportunities to look at climate change and eco-environment change. And we thought, okay, we'll go for that. And we built on a simple project that we'd already got, which was about putting neighbours together, and built that into a project called Transition Streets. And that involved, in the end, 68 streets, so there were loads of people involved in that. And the idea of that project, there was a little workbook that everybody used, and they came together. Of course, if they're in the same street, they've got the same kind of houses. So the question, come back to that question again, question was, how could you live with less of a carbon footprint than you do now? And we all looked at our houses and thought, oh yeah, actually, oh goodness, does the heating work that way? And oh, does it? And where's the water? And how can you check for leaks and so on? So those were the kind of conversations we had. And we did reduce our energy use. We put solar panels on our roofs, because we got a grant. Some people got a grant for that, not everybody, but anyway. So we started to look at renewable energy and so on, as a group. But the most enduring thing from that project, I'm sure you're not surprised to know, was the fact that the neighbours met each other, sometimes for the first time, and talked with each other. And in my street, we still meet, and that's 7 years, we've got a little book club now. So it changed the climate in our road, let alone changing the climate. So those projects, and like the food projects, you don't really know how many people touch it. In terms of activists, it's obviously a much smaller number, but the engagement is greater. So Caring Town, you know, there's loads of people involved in that. So I, you know, that could touch all sorts of people, anyone who needs it. There's help there. So the answer to the question is, I have no idea. But depending on the project, it reaches quite far. Activists, I have no idea, a couple of hundred maybe, I don't know.
Really?